Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Deconstructing My Facade presentation, Jesus reminds us of the tools required to deconstruct our facade, examines the process of deconstruction, and recommends the development of the global emotion of faith and the removal of the global emotion of refusal to experience terror and pain. Recorded on the 7th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, well, this, remember I said earlier in the day that that a lot of the stuff we're going to be going through today and tomorrow, you're not up to yet. And this is a part, what we're going to cover now is the part that many of you will get up to as soon as you accept your facade. So then comes the deconstruction of it. So that's what we're focusing our attention on now, the deconstruction of my facade. And we look at the different things we need to understand about deconstructing it, which is really quite simple if you think about the diagram and you look at what we've covered already. You can see really what the underlying intentions are, but we'll go through the underlying intentions of the process of deconstruction. This is where you learn a lot of lessons about love in this area here. And you can see in your outline, there's quite a few lessons about love at the start of the outline. And honestly, you just learn a lot about love, emotion, holding on to emotion, letting go of emotion, how unloving it is to hold on to emotion and so forth. All right, I think everyone's ready. All right. All right, so remember, if we cast our minds back to the, well, probably even the end of the first day, beginning of the second days, where we were talking about the creation of the facade and then the deconstruction of the facade, what was the underlying desires of the facade? Can you remember that? The state, what's the underlying, it's two primary things that were the underlying state of the facade. So we go to Rachel first on this side. And then down to Neil on this side.
To desensitise from our emotions or from fear.
From what emotions particularly?
Fear, terror.
Well, more of it, isn't it, pain, desensitised to pain. So, because a lot of us are not trying to desensitise from pleasure, right? We're trying to desensitise from pain. So it's a painful emotion. So that's number one. That's the goal of... That's an important thing to remember, isn't it? That's what we're doing, trying to desensitise to pain. And Neil?
Avoid feeling our terror.
So that's the second thing we're doing, is to avoid the emotion of, feeling the emotion of terror. So there's our primary, if we come across to our diagram, the refusal of the emotion of terror is in there. And of course the point of order is to desensitize to the results of our sin, the pain that has been created from the results of our sin. So here we are, we're in this state now, the facade's in this state, very strong demands. In fact, if you think about it, both demands upon the facade are... And remember, these are demands from the pain to the facade. So it's actually the pain and the beliefs about the pain that are driving this. So many of you probably consider, you know, when we talk about facade, you probably haven't considered the motivations of the facade. Remember, the facade is just the humble, obedient servant. I'll do whatever you, the pain, and you, the terror, require of me. That's all it's doing. Whatever it requires. Now, of course, one way of coping with pain and terror is to completely desensitize to it, isn't it? To even believe. And our belief systems are very powerful. Our mind is a very powerful tool that God gave us. And we can use this tool, our mind, our intellect, very negatively. Or we can use it positively. And the very negative use of this tool is to just go along with these demands and just accede to the demands. And this is what the majority of us are doing. We're using their mind and even all of the logical constructs that we're creating in our mind justify the terror and the pain to remain within. Our mind is basically saying, I've got to support this terror and pain from ever coming out. We've got to suppress it, keep it at bay, do whatever we can to keep it underneath me, keep it away from me. Don't let me feel it. Big problem, but it is the major reason why we have the facade. Now, in that place, all of what the facade creates is really inevitable. Can you see that? It's really just inevitable that these things are going to be created. So remember on the first day, I have a vortex of pain that says to me, nobody loves me, nobody loves me. Vortex of pain. I should just feel that pain, but instead of feeling that pain, I want people to love me. So what do? So the false belief is, I need people to love me. Instead of just feeling the pain, which is nobody loves me, and just having a good cry about that, I don't do that. I get into the belief, and the belief is, I need people to love me. The false belief is, love is a something you can demand from people, something you can force them into giving you. Right? So there's my false belief. And because I have that false belief, that terror, so there's this vortex now of give me love, right? Coming into my soul under those circumstances. Now, whatever I do is motivated by the desire to get loved. So now I'm going to automatically create a number of addictions which are all about getting loved. So it's not about giving anymore. And the only reason for giving is that I get. In other words, the only reason why I do something for somebody is so that I get loved. Can you see that? So there's my addiction. My addiction is now, I've got to do things for other people in order to get loved. So I have a desperate need to do something for you so that you'll feel good about me and then I'll feel loved. Very selfish desire if you think about it, isn't it? But it is very strong now within me because of this vortex of emotion, which is all about me not wanting to feel the pain. So not wanting to feel the pain creates a monster. Really. And that's really the case. Not wanting to feel pain is the primary creation of the monster. Right? And of course, the terror of the pain assists us not wanting to feel the pain. So here we are. We're going around with all of these holes. Remember, I just at the beginning, we drew a diagram of all these vortexes in and out. Was that last group? Was this group? Yep. Okay. I sometimes forget. And we have vortexes of emotions coming in and out, in where we need things and out where we feed others so that we get what we need. So this establishes what you would classify as codependent addictions. And in particular, we search now for relationships, friendships, and interactions that feed these demanding vortexes of emotions where we don't feel whole, we don't feel complete within ourselves. So there we are, we're just feeding on them. It's like a glutton frenzy, really, an emotional one. You know, it's like a person who just sits down and there's all this food in front of them and they have to eat the whole lot. You know, have to get it all satisfied. And that's what it actually feels like after a while if you're sensitive to it. It'll feel like a glutton frenzy. It feels really off, actually. But that's what it feels like, eventually, once you tune into it. So here we are in this place. So then the question becomes, this monster of a facade, how do I deconstruct it? What do I need to do to deconstruct it? And I feel the answer is quite obvious. You do the opposite to the very thing that created it. So what created it? Avoiding, having false beliefs that help us avoid pain, and refusing to feel terror. That's what created it. So what in the end is going to be my goal of deconstruction? It's going to be to reverse that choice or decision. So instead of desensitizing from pain, my choice needs to become, from my emotional choice needs to become sensitizing to pain. I want to become more sensitive to pain. The irony is, if I become more sensitive to pain, I also become more sensitive to pleasure, which is the reward, one of the rewards of becoming more sensitive to pain. You also finish up experiencing more pleasure as well. But that's one of my underlying goals, is become more sensitive to pain. The second one is to get down through this labyrinth of addiction, to get down through this denial, through this addiction, into the stage where I now feel my terror. So that's another, you could say, primary goal of our deconstruction process, is to reverse the desire to avoid into having a desire to feel it, the terror, to actually feel it. So I need to go through this process where I'm reversing these two soul-based decisions. Remember, these are will-based decisions that are heavily guarded within our soul. Will-based decision at the moment is to desensitize from pain and to avoid terror. And what we need to do is to turn that over into a will-based decision to sensitize to pain and a will-based decision to feel terror, to experience terror. And there's basically the deconstruction process. And we're done. Right? So it's quite a simple process, really, isn't it? The deconstruction process. Now, the problem is, there is quite a labyrinth up there in the facade. It's like a labyrinth, isn't it? You remember those old mazes that, you know, I don't know if you ever did that as a kid, where you went to a maze place, you know, and you go, dead end. Then you got to go back. And then you go, and you can't even get back sometimes. It's like dead ends everywhere. And then you go, another dead end, you know. And eventually you might get there, but it feels very much like that when you start digging into this. Like, just like quite frequently, lots of different areas or tentacles. I often think of it like this sort of bowl, if you like. Have you ever seen one of those Van de Graaff generators, you know, which is a generator of high voltage electrical field, that when you put your hand over it, it sort of follows your hand, you know, and you get all these sparks flying off and everything. And I often think about it like your facade is sort of like that in a lot of ways, in terms of the way that you just go where there, and there's all these addictions coming, and all these addictions, it's just attractions, you know, everywhere. And it's like a great big labyrinth of fireworks, really, in a lot of ways, causing a lot of damage as a result. And the key is to look at what's causing it, what's driving it. Right. Now, that sounds simple, right? Pretty simple. Everyone's okay with that? Yeah, doing it, you know, is pretty tough, because particularly if you haven't accepted your facade yet, it's going to be impossible, actually, to do that. But there's another thing that's the problem, and that is getting to the point to want to be sensitive to pain And getting to the point of wanting to be feeling terror is a process that you're going to have to go through. And that requires removing all of the tools you use to avoid these things. And what are the tools you use? Your addictions. And can you see that it's many of you want to skip over this process? It's a very frustrating process of removing most, if not all, of your addictions. And most of you want to skip over that. You want to sort of get to your pain, get it over and done with. Not have to come face to face with this terrible monster that you've created, the addictions, you know, it's like, and the facade. Make out it's not there and we'll get to this. Not understanding that this is the creator of most of your additional sin. And you need to understand that. You need to get that. God wants you to have an awakening to your sin. You cannot receive God's love unless you have an awakening to sin. At some point, you're going to have to continue receiving God's love. You're going to have an awakening to sin. An awakening to your choice to break God's laws. And your choices to break God's laws, besides the two primary choices, which are these two choices, which causes a lot of breaking God's laws, is driven by the facade. The facade has this belief, doesn't it? It's fed by this belief that you're allowed to do anything, that justifies avoiding terror and not feeling pain. Anything. You're allowed to kill, rape, pillage, lie, steal, anything to avoid these things. That's what the facade believes, because it's told to believe that by the terror and the fear of pain. Anything. And therefore it becomes the engine creating your sin, creating more sin, because it believes that anything should be able to be engaged. So you can see that deconstruction of my facade now not only involves the goal, so you could say, if I write it up this way, you could say our goal, there's the goal of the facade currently, and we want to transfer that goal into different goals, don't we? Exactly the opposite. So the new goal is to, one, sensitize to pain. And the second goal, to feel terror. So here we are. There's our goals, but to achieve those goals requires work on my addictions. You can see that, can't you? Yeah, it's going to require work on my addictions. And for many of us, even just work on the fact, remember we raised in our group truth, remember we raised that we're even in total denial, many of us, so we have to first work on our denial before we can even get to our addictions. Yeah. So we're going to have to do some work up here. Okay, so then the question becomes, what work? Doesn't it? Can you see that? What work? All right. So is there any questions up to that stage? So Ivana, would you like to ask?
So when you said before about the addictions, removing the addictions, you're talking about like emotionally removing them, not just stopping the addictive activity.
Correct.
But actually emotionally feeling through and letting go.
Because every addiction has an emotion driving the need for the addiction to be met. And unless you remove the emotion that drives the need, you're not going to stop the addiction.
And you always just want to revert back to it.
Yeah. And and doing it the other way means you're using willpower, not will.
Yep.
And we've said in the past, willpower is pretty much useless.
Yep.
Yep. So there has to be a soul-based thing going on here towards these addictions. A soul-based thing where you're willing to actually start to release the desire. Now, one thing that most people don't realize about addictions is that it's not your pain that drives them. It's your avoidance of pain that drives them. Your avoidance of the emotional pain that drives them. And the decision to engage addictions can be stopped even without feeling the pain. There is a different group of pains that cause you to desire addiction. And are pains associated with anger and rage and justifications that you have, excuses that you make, all those tools of deny, those techniques that you use. Releasing the techniques of denial is the key. Does that make sense?
Yeah, something I haven't done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for most people, what they do is they go, oh, I noticed this addiction. I'll stop that in my life. Done, dusted, no worries. But there's still a feeling in you of wanting it. And unless that feeling and the justification of that feeling changes, at some point you're going to go back to having it. You are. So, Alex, you'd like to ask? Up.
Thank you. Always forget. So does that mean crying about feeling the addiction when it's not met and crying about that you're not getting it, and also accepting the fact that it's a sin and God's truth around it?
Well, crying about an addiction not getting met, although you need to feel all of your emotions, of course, crying about an addiction not getting met is just having a tantrum. You've got to see the reason for the tantrum, is what I'm suggesting. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
The reason for it. So for example, if we looked at an addiction from a physical point of view.
Okay, cool.
Because physical addictions are easy to sort of relate to, right, for most people. So if we look at a physical addiction, so let's say every night you come home from work, you've got to have a beer. You've got to have an alcoholic drink of some kind. Let's say it's that. And every night it's got to be, right? Then you hear about this addictions and you look at your life and you go, oh, yeah, you know, you become aware, you got over denial now, and you become aware that probably needing a drink every night is probably an addiction, right? So then you decide, I'm going to remove having a drink every night. Now, that hasn't changed the feeling you have as to why you need the drink, has it? It's only changed your willpower has decided that you're going to make a change, and so you make a change. But the need for the desire to have the desire itself is not addressed. It hasn't been dealt with. So that at some point, if somebody comes along and says, would you like to come out for drinks? You're probably going to say yeah, because not only now has your desire not been addressed, the fact that you'd really like to, but also now you're getting an external influence, which is probably highly likely you'll follow, because your external desire is saying for you to follow it. You want to follow it. And so you give yourself allowances. You go, oh, it's just this one night, I'll do that, without thinking that, no, this is still an indication that the desire is not being released. The desire, unless it's released, is going to drive my behaviour. Can you see that from a physical perspective? Yeah. So what was your emotional one that you had?
One that's been coming up for me is that I can't make Monique do what I want.
Okay, yep. So you could cry about it, right, or get angry about it, but that's just you having a tantrum, right?
Yep.
So what's driving your thinking that you should be able to make Monique do what you want?
Oh, right. So you, now you're going into causal of what's, well, the fact that...
Yeah, be careful about the terminology phrases.
Well, what's causing or what's driving...
What belief inside of you believes that you can actually get somebody else to do what they want?
Oh, that... Yeah.
Now, that's not related to your pain yet.
No.
This is up here. There's a belief up here that's been established saying, I'm allowed to demand that Monique does what I want.
That a woman should do what I want.
A woman should do what I want, if it's for a woman, a man, if it's for a man, or it could be just generally everyone should do what I want, if it applies to everyone. But I would then project at her that she's doing the unloving thing by not doing what I want. And you'll even reason with her about it. You'll even try to reason with her. And when that doesn't work, you get... angry about it, because then, what does anger do? Anger is like a power thing. It's like, you do what I want or else type of thing, right? A threat, really. So all of those behaviours are driven by the belief, something inside of yourself that believes you're allowed to do this to this girl. Do you see?
Yeah.
And, you know, one of those beliefs is if she's my soulmate, she'll do what I want. It could be as simple as that. Or it could be, but what you're not seeing, if I can just pause for a moment, what you're not seeing is that it's unloving to demand that somebody else does what I want.
Yeah.
So therefore, the addiction is it's saying that it's okay for somebody to force somebody to do what I'm wanting and to get angry with them when they don't. Now, that decision... is not necessarily related to the pain of why you want her to do what you want.
Right.
Why you want her to do what you want might be all sorts of reasons. In your childhood, you never had a woman do what you want. Or it could be that in your childhood, mummy always did what you wanted.
She did everything. Yeah.
She did everything for you. And so now you expect the woman to do everything for you.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
So that's the pain, but you're not going to get there yet because you've got a justification for the addiction. And the justification for the addiction has to be identified in order to be released. You follow?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. And this is what I see most of you avoiding. You're avoiding the reasons for your justifications for your addictions. And one reason is because you have so much judgment about addiction, you don't even go there. You have yet to accept your facade, so you're yet to accept your addiction, so you don't even look at why you have them, what's going on, what drives them. What's the belief systems that drive your addictions? So what I'm suggesting here is the overall goal is to get to this stage where we're sensitive to pain and we're feeling our terror. But in order to do that, I'm going to have to examine all of my justifications for keeping my addictions. And I have heaps of them. And I minimize, justify, support them, do a whole heap of things to do that. Now, I'm going to have to deconstruct that because they are mine. Nobody else can do that for me. And I've got to see how each one of them is unloving. This is why I say deconstructing your facade is where you learn a lot about unloving behavior. You learn a lot about what's loving, what's not loving. The reason why many of you cannot tell what's loving and what's unloving, because you're yet to deconstruct your facade. You're still on the process of accepting it yet, and not deconstructing it yet.
So I'm having intellectual realizations, oh, this sucks, you know, this is, I'm just demanding from her and all that kind of stuff.
So you know the behavior is wrong from an intellectual perspective, but something in your soul is telling you it's right.
Yeah.
And that's what you've got to find. And it's not pain. It's to do with justification of your facade.
Yeah, I kind of automatically want to go to my pain in that.
You do. Most people will automatically want to go, when I was little, I didn't have many women do what I wanted and that's why I really want this. No, it's not. It's not why. That's your justification as to why, but it's not why. And you start feeling, isn't it terrible how women didn't do what I wanted when I was little? And it's all just a self-delusion created to avoid the real problem which is happening up here in the justification of your addiction.
So can I ask what sort of examples might be the cause of that?
Well, I gave one, and that is when I was a young child, I got everything I wanted from my mother. mothers are taught nowadays in the Western world that that's how you be a good mother. You do everything for your child that needs to be done, but your mother never weaned you off that. Right? And as a result of that, as an adult, you still have the thing that a woman should do everything you want.
But isn't that the pain?
No. The pain is what? Feelings of superiority over women. That's the feeling of pain. That's the pain. You feel your mum taught you, the real pain is your mum taught you to be superior and feel as if you are superior to women. That's the real pain. But you're not getting at that, right? You're just justifying up here in your addiction that you should get what you want from women. That's not the pain. That's the result of the facade at work. Does that make sense? Now, the truth is you can identify that once you've actually accepted your facade. It's much easier to identify what I just said. But until then, most of you will be going, oh, but I'm down here in my pain. I'm down here in my pain. And this is what the last group found. We had a talk tomorrow about releasing my pain. They asked me a question about releasing my pain. I said, it's got nothing to do with your pain. You're up here. You're demanding this, demanding that, thinking you should, and you've get crying about something that's all just a self-delusion. And every question that got asked, back up here, back up here, back up here. And the reason why is because everyone thinks they're down here when they're actually here. They haven't even deconstructed their facade yet enough to know that that emotion that's driving them is actually completely independent of the actual pain that exists within them. And once you've gone through the process, you realize all that automatically. Every friend I've ever had going through these processes in the spirit world automatically gets to the same realizations. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, cool. Thanks.
Yep. Good question, though. If we go across to Graham, thanks.
Do we get help in terms of what we should deal with next in terms of our addictions and stuff? Like my TV blew up.
Yep.
You know, and I thought, I have a choice here. I can just go out and buy another one.
Yep.
Or I can feel what this brings up for me.
Yes, we have both leadings, I would call them, of guidance, and we also have choices we can make. Most of us don't make the choices because we're so heavily in the addiction, we don't want to make the choice. You see? And so what happens is the law of attraction, God's laws, are always trying to confront our unhealed, unloving condition. So they will expose different events as a result. So our soul creates an event through the attraction to expose an emotion that we then have the choice to either feel or not feel. That's the normal way we go through it. Or we can choose to confront that. So for example, I had at one stage I had two vehicles. This was like years ago. I had a sports car and a car for business, basically, or a second car. This was me, one person. I was living by myself, two vehicles. Now, sooner or later, I could have crashed both vehicles, had accidents for both vehicles. So sooner or later, the law of attraction would expose this particular addiction that I have. So I could either have a crash of both vehicles or one of those vehicles, or I could have attracted events where one got stolen, or I could have attracted, or I can choose to actually deal with the addiction. Either or. I chose to deal with addiction and sold both vehicles. So I had no vehicles. And instead a push bike is how I got around. Now I did that for nearly 3 years. I didn't have a vehicle. Push bike only. And the reason why I did that was to remove what it was my addictions creating the other thing. So it was a purposeful choice. You can either make a purposeful choice or you can have and attract a whole series of events happening. One of the two. It just depends on what your soul base will is, how your soul base will is engaged.
Like with the TV thing, it felt like I probably have more will to feel and not actually go and get another TV, then I would have had will to turn the TV off and leave it switched off.
Yeah, that's interesting too, isn't it? So in the end, I got some cars after I dealt with my stuff and then felt about them.
So it feels a little bit like I'm getting help to find, you know, putting things in front of my face to show me what's a good thing to work on at the time.
Yeah.
And if I do make the choice to actually work on it, well, it's a bit easier than if I had of intellectually decided, I'm going to tackle this addiction to TV and leave the TV turned off.
Yes, so you could have chosen that though, to leave it turned off, and after a while, if you felt your emotions, you'd feel all the things that are driving you to turn it back on, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but I don't have as much will to do that as what I would.
Yeah, because it's there. See, this is the thing with temptation, right? Something that's right in your face is harder to deal with than something that's not right in your face. So this is, but it doesn't mean that the addiction has been gone. So it's like pornography for many of you guys, right? Like if there's none in the house, then you don't look at it. But if you go and get some, if you do look at it, you still feel like looking at it. There's the addiction in play. Do you see what I'm saying? And so for me, it's like, oh, keep some in the house and see what happens to me, whether I want to look at it, whether I feel like looking at it or not.
Yeah, but you've got a lot more will to do that than what I have.
Well, you're assuming that, Grant. Like the reality is, yes, I do now, but years ago, no, I didn't.
Like for me, turning off the TV and leaving it turned off would require willpower.
Well, you see, now you're starting to get what's willpower and what's will. And we've already defined what willpower is and what will is. You could actually determine through your will to turn it off.
Yeah, but
no, purposefully to address the underlying emotion that makes you want to turn it back on again. Right? You could.
I can aspire to have that will.
You could aspire to have it. You develop that will, and eventually you can have it, and then you'll go and turn it off.
Yeah.
Right? Or you can willpower yourself and turn it off, and then see what happens. Right? But the first course of action is better than the second. Develop the will. Not just use your willpower.
But in the meantime, this just going with my law of attraction.
Whose law of attraction? It's not yours.
What do you mean?
It's God's law.
Oh, okay.
It's not yours. You never made it. You're just living it. Right?
Okay. Going with God's law of attraction that I'm experiencing.
Yes, because your soul has attracted through that law a condition where something happened to your telly, and most probably that's occurred to inform you of something, to be reflective about something here. Does that make sense?
Well, I've known for some time I have this addiction.
Yeah. Because I don't think I've ever had a telly break down on me my whole life.
Yeah. Yeah. But...
What do you want to say, Graham? Just say it.
Well, I'm not sure at this point.
Okay.
I'll probably finish my question.
No worries. So what I'm illustrating is, yes, law of attraction events do occur, attracted by your soul to expose different conditions to you. And also your guides and God himself is trying to expose to you what you need to work on, what's interfering with your life, right? Those things are all happening. Now, I can choose to see those things, or I can just allow the law of attraction to bring them to me. Can't I? I can do either. I can choose through the exercise of my will, not my willpower, my mind, but my will to address those issues. Or I can choose to just wait and just see what God brings me through the law. I can do either. Now, if you wait and choose to wait to bring you what God brings you, then of course your progress will be slower. That's all. Yep. And there might be some things that you might be waiting, like, you know, there's six fear spirits who've been on the six fear for 1,000 years, waiting for the attraction to bring them certain events and situations to make them aware. And of course the attraction is always doing that, but their denial of their own awareness, their own desire to not analyze, is causing the slowdown, a stagnancy in their own progression. You can choose either, though, is what I'm suggesting. It's your will, it's your life, it's your choice. God loves you no matter what you choose. You're just not going to feel God's love no matter what you choose. Because if you choose to stay in your addictions, God's not going to feed any of them. So you won't be very happy, and you definitely won't have a relationship with God while you choose that. And that's the penalty, if you like, of not choosing differently, not being able to have that relationship. Yeah? Now, how am I going, Tom? Just let me look. I'm still going okay, I think. 3:10, 3:10. Yeah, 20 minutes, okay. Just keeping in mind what I've got to cover. So one more question there, Luli, and then we'll just move on.
So I think... No, start again. Can you remove physical and all of those addictions and feel through the emotions, and they're not... The emotions aren't the same... That you don't have to go down to that pain down there to release the addictions up there. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Oh, right.
Because yeah. They have nothing to do with that. When I say they have nothing to do, there are certain linkages that exist. There's certain relationships that exist. But your justification for your addictions is completely different to the reason, the pain that might drive them. See, you can. The reality is you can have pain. And on top of that, you can choose to then use that pain as an excuse to drive a whole heap of other things. And what I'm suggesting to you is having pain and then excusing it to do a whole heap of bad things are two different processes. Does everyone get that? Having pain is one thing. You got your pain created through the creation process we've been through on day one. That pain is there. That's one thing. It's there. You justifying it and then using the justification of it to do a whole heap of damaging things to other people and yourself is a completely different thing. You can choose to not justify it, or you can choose to justify it. And what we're doing in this phase here is we're justifying our addictions. We're telling ourselves, I'm allowed to demand them. I'm allowed to have them. How dare you suggest that I should remove them? That's how we feel, isn't it not? It's exactly how we feel. Now, the how dare you suggest that I remove them is a completely different emotion than me actually having the pain that exists that drives them. And that's what most of us don't realize yet, because we're yet to deconstruct our addictions. You see, you realize that after you've done it. You realize the difference.
So it's feeling through those justifications. That is what releases the addiction.
It's not only justifications. Remember, it's the denial, the excuses, the minimizations, the justifications, the judging, the shifting the blame, the blaming me, blaming others, punishing me, punishing others. All of those things are anger actions, anger-based actions to support your addiction. And those decisions are made up here. They're not made because of this. You can have an intense amount of pain and still not engage addictions. Is that good? Mary wants to, you wanted to make some points about that, babe?
No, I just wanted to, you're right, it's kind of a clarifying question. But,
yes, yeah.
But basically you're saying that there's sinful beliefs within the facade that we need to awaken to.
Correct.
But it seems to me, through my own experience, that many of the justifications that exist in the facade and the sinful beliefs are kind of common to my family background. So
the other reasons why they have their facade and their sinful beliefs.
They feel certain things, like we talked about the other day, about how someone who loves me doesn't trigger my crying.
Yeah.
And that's not really related to a pain, that's just a false belief that I've imbibed.
Through the facade. So one of
the family environment.
Yeah, so one of Mary's family environment beliefs is anybody who triggers any crying in you is a bad person. Right. Now that's happening up here in them. Because down here, in your pain, you don't feel that at all. I'm crying and it's good, is what you feel down here. It's only up here that you feel I'm crying and it's bad. Right. So this is tells you you're up here, not down there in that belief, you see. This is why there's the excuses, the justifications, the minimizations and all those things, all those techniques are all a part of the facade's choices. Remember when we talked to you about the creation of the facade, remember we said that's when you created these techniques. See, many of you didn't get that at the time, right? But that's the reality. When the facade got created, the techniques got created. The justifications, the minimizations, they all got created. They all support your facade. They're, if you like, the foundation for your facade. Saying, I'm allowed to demand this. I'm allowed to sin when I want to. I'm allowed to do it because. Whatever the becauses are, you know, whatever the reasons are, I'm allowed to do it. And you're going to have to deconstruct them because no one else is going to do it for you. No one else will ever do it for you. Other people will expose it for you. The law of attraction will expose them for you. God's laws will expose them for you. Your spirit guides will expose them for you. But you will need to address them. Nobody else can do it for you because it's your creation. It's not something God created. It's your creation. You see? And this is why most of you are yet to begin this process, you see, because it's like you've not understood that the emotions driving your addictions are very, very different to the emotions driving your pain. Yeah. They often have thin relationships, but sometimes they have no relationship at all. Right? And these justifications all came from your parents, society's justifications and your own choices in your facade, what you chose to do, and this additional sin you create as a result of the justifications all happens up here. So what we've said now, if we want to summarize what we're up to so far, right? We're basically saying this is the current goal of our facade. This is what the new goal of our facade needs to be, to sensitise to pain and feel terror. But the only problem is getting from there to there involves removing a lot of these physical, emotional and spiritual addictions because they cover all over these things. Right? They cover it all over. They make them all seem like they're not there even. Right? So I'm going to have to do a lot of work here. So then the question becomes, how do I do that work? Well, we've already told you 2 years ago how to do that work in the deconstruction of my facade presentation in 2014. So I'm not going to go through it again except to say that firstly, you'll need the intellectual awareness process and then you will need to apply the emotional awareness process to those feelings. So you first need to become intellectually aware, for example, like if I can just use Alex's situation with Monique as an example that he raised earlier, he needs to become aware that it's actually wrong. So he's got intellectual awareness that it's actually wrong to demand of another person that they do what you want. So he's got an intellectual awareness of that. So he's already gone through the intellectual awareness of that. He intellectually sees that it's probably a sin, that it's probably bad to do that. But he still feels like doing it. So that tells you that the emotional process has not happened yet about that drive. And part of the reason why is because he has not yet allowed himself to feel the reason why he feels like doing it. And to feel that, he's going to firstly have to accept his facade that he actually feels like doing it. You see? He's got to see that he feels like doing it still. And then he's got to find why. And that is a process that he needs to go through for himself. Does that make sense? No one else can do that for him. People can help him. People can explain things to him. Mon can tell him about how it feels for her or whatever. But at the end of the day, it's something you have to do in your own process. The justifications for taking an action to harm another happen here. The fear of doing something about your pain happens here. And the false beliefs associated with pain happen here. And the pain itself is the pain itself, but most of us are not nowhere near that, right? And when I say most, I feel everyone in this audience pretty much bar Mary. Mary's here. Most of you guys are here. Mary spent a good solid, probably 7 years dealing with this. Does that make sense? So this is where we're at. We're not even yet there because for the majority of us, as Mary pointed out to you in your review, majority of you are still judging your facade. So that means you haven't even accepted yet. Because you keep judging it, you haven't accepted it. You still don't have compassion for it. Still think it's something you should punish yourself about. So not even accepted it yet. So once we've accepted it, then we can go through this addiction, the deconstruction of it, which is all about getting rid of those addictions. As many as possible. We want to get rid of as many as possible until we start feeling our fear of the pain that we have and our fear of the terror we have. Right? Still we start feeling the terror, still we start feeling the pain, we're going to continue to deconstruct until, so the goal is to get through this fog, because that's what it really is, isn't it? It's like fog to desensitize us to what's really going on. We want to get through this fog until we can see with clarity the terror and the pain. And you're not going to see with clarity the terror or the pain until you get through the fog. So I can talk to you about your pain, and tomorrow we'll talk a bit about it, but it's going to be very, very hard for you to even feel it while the fog's there. It's like, what? What? I don't really get you. That's how it feels. You know, if you reflect upon many of the Paget messages that you read from the Paget messages, the ones that are in the first sphere of the spirit world, when a higher spirit comes to them, there's often, what they've said is often, oh, he talks to me, but I don't understand what he's saying. But he's speaking English and I still don't get it, right? That's what they're saying in those messages. And the reason why is because that's what it feels like in that place. In that place, it just feels like you're looking at everything through a fog and somebody comes and tells you something about your pain. It's like, what are you talking about? Right? I've got no idea what you're talking about. Tell me again so I can understand. You're trying to, no, I still don't get it. What are you talking about? Maybe you're wrong. You've got to be wrong because I don't understand. Or you start punishing yourself for not understanding. You go, oh, no, I'm a terrible person. I just don't get it. I don't get it. And there I am. What am I doing now? Haven't yet accepted my facade even. I'm still just trying to act out that I'm a terrible person, which I'm not, for not understanding something. So this is our problem. It's a big problem. And this is what you'll go through when you start deconstructing this facade in a sincere manner. Very powerful process. Beautiful process God's designed, actually. Fab.
So really, like you were saying before, in this process, we really get to learn to love who we are, really ourselves, quite intensely, really. Like, even if we have deep amounts of rage, like we still love that person that has that rage. And
yeah, and we see why it's being created, we see our motivations around it, we see our justifications of it. You'll get to understand yourself so well.
We'll even let ourselves feel it too, wouldn't we? Like,
you will come to understand yourself so well that you won't need another person to understand you, because you understand yourself.
Yeah.
Which is fantastic, right?
Yeah.
It's also a place where you start having the development of a lot of really positive qualities, even like, you know, you start to develop some love of yourself because you start feeling, oh, wow, like there's another thing I've just felt and worked through and found. And isn't that really good? See, I'm not judging it anymore. So I'm not attacking myself anymore for it. I'm now just going, oh, there's another thing, and isn't it wonderful? I've got through that as well. And can you see that every new emotion you address in this area is just another sort of thing in the weight of faith? You know, like you start building faith as a result. Every new thing, I see this going on. There's another evidence for my faith being built. Because I've now learned I can get rid of that, I can deal with that, I can address that. And so what happens is you build in this place, you build up many, you process many emotional things, and as you process it emotionally, what you're really doing is you're building faith about dealing with pain as well. So you're actually building your faith as a part of that process, as an actual process. You feel, the more you address and the more you're able to see, the more faith you have that you can cope with the next step. So it's a wonderful process like that. It's a very natural process. Like many of you are worried about developing faith, but if you just take these steps towards acceptance of your facade and then actually the deconstruction of it, in the deconstruction process is where you gain a lot of faith. That you're doing the right thing, that it's working, that things can now change. You start touching occasionally your terror and then more and more your terror, and eventually it's like bang in your face, which is the goal, right? We want it to be bang in our face so that we can feel it. See, but many of us have not had that goal. We're going, I don't want to feel it. I don't want to feel it. So our goal is still up here, right? Still in the wrong goal. So you can see also that there's two primary things that we're going to need, qualities-wise, right, for the deconstruction process. So you could call these deconstruction notes now, sort of thing. So the first primary quality, pretty obvious. What is it going to be? Faith. I'm going to need the faith. So, you know, in this stage, yeah, not much faith. We're going, what are you talking about? You know, what are you talking about with us? Like that kind of thing. You know, because we're trying to avoid the sensitization process. So when somebody tells us, you know, we've got to go through this process that feels quite traumatic at times, we go, don't tell me that I've got to do that, right? Once you have some faith in God and God's goodness and also faith that this is the way you get to receive God's love, and therefore this is the way you get to receive an education, is by getting rid of all the things that block the education that you've constructed. So I need to get rid of the things that block my education. These are the things that are blocking my education. It's my excuses, my justifications, my denials, my minimization of all the unloving things I do. This causes me to not be sensitive to God's love and not be sensitive to this education. So this is the work I've got to do on myself to awaken myself to sin, awaken myself to the results of it, and eventually its causes. See, and when I do that, obviously the more I do that, faith will develop. But even before I begin, I've got to see that there's a good reason for doing it. Without doing it, I'm never going to have my relationship with God. And then we've got to see, well, what's the point of having a relationship with God? At the moment, people on earth basically feel there's not much point to it. So we've even got to have enough faith to see that there's a point to it, that there's a reason for having a relationship with God, that it's going to benefit my life in some way. So I've got to develop enough faith to motivate me even to do that. Like, otherwise, I'm not going to do it, am I? I'm just going to sit there and go, addictions, yeah, you're taking away all my fun. How dare you take away all my fun? That's what we're going to feel until we start realizing that maybe it's not so much fun. Maybe there's a lot of pain there that it covers over that I need to address. And maybe I'm actually causing a lot more pain in this place, and I have to have some faith that even that's happening before I'll begin deconstructing it. So faith, essential quality. Next essential quality, humility. In fact, this is what you're now developing as a positive quality. Can you see that? You're developing it because now you've accepted your facade. You're now going, I have one. At least that's a state where humility is beginning, isn't it? But then to go even further and to feel the reason why you want it, that requires a lot of humility, doesn't it? A lot of desire to be humble to what's going on, right? And so what happens in this phase is you go from being a proud, arrogant, peed off person, right? Angry all the time and always wanting your addictions met or whatever, into a person who softens and softens and softens and is more and more humble as you go. And you get to the point where somebody can discuss with you 25 different emotions that you have that are out of harmony with love, and you can sit there and handle the conversation. Because for the majority at the moment, if somebody tells you one emotion, you can't handle it, right? Which is an indication of the lack of humility, right? And this is where we're going. We're going to the point where, so we're now through the process of deconstructing my facade. I'm now developing more faith because I have to have faith to do it. And as a part of the process, my humility begins and strengthens. And remember, humility, tool number four is humility, isn't it? The desire to experience and release all emotions. That's humility. So it's all about getting to the state where I am humble. Now, of course, I'm going to have to be really humble in order to finish up in this state, aren't I? So you can see that building your way through the deconstruction of your addictions actually builds humility enough to get to this stage where you're now sensitive to pain and you're now prepared to feel terror. So now you've got enough humility to get beyond the facade and down into what's going to release and cause major changes in your life when it does release. Everyone get that? Isn't it so beautiful? Yes. It is beautiful, really, when you think about it, that the very things you need to engage in order to do that process, this deconstruction of my facade process, are going to be the very things you need to a great degree in order to actually feel these things. So it's a developing process. You're developing. You're changing. Right? Hmm. Things to ponder about, right? God, clever, clever God. You know? And all of God's laws, including the law of compensation, the law of attraction, law of cause and effect, and many, many other laws of which you're not currently aware, are all helping you already to go through that process. And a lot of it's about just becoming personally aware, getting out of denial, becoming personally aware, even intellectually, to begin the process. And to go through the process of developing intellectual awareness and then eventually this emotional awareness that you're going to need in order to feel pain. You, down here, to feel the results of your sin, the pain, and let it go. And by the time you're getting down here now, your body's healing, things are changing, sickness is disappearing, and so forth. Right? Very natural sort of a process. Yeah. So my feelings are, it's such a beautiful way, you know, like, and, you know, God's way, you'd expect it to be, would you not? Such a beautiful way, one step leading you to another, leading you to another, as a free sort of a process. Hardly requiring any effort of my own except for the fact that I've got to give up a bit of denial and give up a few addictions. I suppose you laugh because you think there's hundreds of them. And you're probably right. But you can see that it's like, in terms of what I have to do and in terms of what God does, can you see why Solomon wrote the message about faith and love? Faith being the first thing that we're going to need to go through the awakening process. Once we go through the awakening process, our humility develops as a natural course. It's a natural process. If you go through this process the way God designed you to go through this process, you will naturally have humility at the end of it. Every celestial spirit, lovely, humble people. That's why a celestial spirit can come to Paget and he writes down their experience while they're on earth, you know, and some of them murdered me, right? So, you know, and they were freely talking about the fact that they had, completely open about their own experience. Some of them told you that, you know, like some of them in the Paget messages talk about, like you would talk about Nero and ones like that, talk about the debauchery and the terrible things they were into for years and years and years and the terrible experience in the spirit world as a result of it. And one case he says, you could not imagine the pain that I was in. You could not even imagine it. So he's telling his experience, but it's over now. He's finished it. He's done it. He's done the awakening process to his own sin. Yeah, there we go. Deconstructing my facade. Now there's a lot more that we could say about it, but I think I've made the main points about it. Yeah. And the key for you is to do a bit more research and understand the intellectual deconstruction process and the emotional deconstruction process, and to understand that these are emotions. Like every time you excuse something, it's an emotion driving it, a justification of a belief driving it, that you can excuse it, that you should excuse it, that you should be able to get away with excusing it. Same goes with denial, same goes with shifting the blame, same goes with punishing yourself, same goes with self-pity. These are all emotions up in the facade driving your addictions to be fulfilled, to be satisfied. And the deconstruction process is going to help you deconstruct all of those justification-based emotions to the point where you have so much humility that you're able to touch your terror and stay with it, and that you're able to touch your pain and stay with it until it's done. And after that, the monster has disappeared. You imagine for a moment that the majority of your facade has been deconstructed, and you're now touching your terror and you're touching your pain, you now have learnt a lot of humility and you've also now got a much stronger faith. Can you see that you'd be a much softer person, a much more open person? You know, automatically you'd be more loving, wouldn't you? In that place, more aware of other people's emotions, more aware of your own, automatic. You don't have to worry about becoming aware, the process makes you aware. You don't have to wonder, you know, how do I become aware? What do I have to learn to become aware? Because the process itself creates awareness. That's why it's such a wonderful process. Does the very things you're going to need for the next step. Okay, well, it's probably time for me to have a break. And so we'll have a 10-minute break. It's 10-minute break, isn't it? Yep, and I'm 10 minutes over, sorry guys. So 10-minute break, if we come back at 3:30, and then we'll do a Q&A on this subject of deconstructing my facade.